Hello again, ladies and gentlemen. I am here again, your host, Dr. Raja Nadir Jalal, with part two of my interpersonal skill video series about essential communication and interpersonal skills for CLAP 2. So, as I discussed in my previous video as well, which was part one of this series, that what are interpersonal skills and why they are important. So I briefly want to revise that what are interpersonal skills and why they are so important. So interpersonal skills means using your emotional intelligence to engage and communicate with your patients in an effective, empathetic and meaningful way rather than just applying your medical knowledge. So good interpersonal skills make your patients feel respected, cared and empowered, and they are motivated to participate more in their personal health care. And good communication skills are critical for understanding patients' actual issues, motivating them to engage in their health care, and delivering the most effective treatments possible. And a doctor with good interpersonal skills can actually achieve better clinical results. And some of the key interpersonal skills, as we discussed in our previous video, are building good rapport and trust with your patient, being attentive and an active listener, reflecting back on what patient is telling you, and the ability to explore what is in your patient's mind. Then ability to identify actual issues and problem solving ability, and the ability to motivate your patient, showing social courtesy, and the most important of all is empathy, which allows for doctors to better understand and relate to their patients. So this is why interpersonal skills are so important, and that's why 4 marks are only allocated to interpersonal skills in CLAP 2 OSCE stations. So coming to our first scenario, first situation, when we deal with an angry patient. So I am discussing about interpersonal skills. So you have to use phrases, I am sorry about what happened. I can see this is very frustrating for you at this point. I can clearly see you are annoyed by this situation. It may be difficult, Mr. Smith, to discuss all this while we are standing. Should we sit down and see if I can help best? I am sorry you might feel irritated by some of my questions, but it's important for me to know what exactly happened. Mr. Smith, I'll try to do everything to make sure that we resolve the situation. So this is how you deal when you encounter a patient who is very angry because of one thing or another. And you need to calm down the situation, and then you will be able to move forward to address the issues which are making this patient angry. Then you can say that, let's see if we can move the situation forward. How about if I do this and if I do that? How does this sound? Or how about if I talk to the doctor or nurse or my seniors in order to move the situation forward? You can say that, I can assure you that after our discussion, I will go to get your medication. For example, if patient is angry because medications were not given at time, or I will go to get your test results if test result or report is late, or if X-ray report is delayed. So you can say, I will go to get your X-ray report straight away and I will come back and discuss with you. So this is how you deal with an angry patient. Or next patient might be a patient who is not interested to listen to you. In this situation, you can say that, I can see that you don't want to discuss your health condition today. You don't seem to be too concerned about your condition. I can appreciate that there might be many other things going on in your mind. Would you like to share with me? I know you don't really want to be here. You didn't really want to be here, but now that you are here, is there anything that you think I can do for you? Is there any way that you would like us to address your problems? Do you have any idea what might be going on? Let's talk about anything that worries you the most. Let's look at your medications. Let's look at some of the risk factors. Let's look at your lifestyle. and to help save you from any complication that may arise in the long run. In this way, you can make the patient feel more comfortable and make him a little bit willing to discuss about his or her health condition or concerns or issues with you. You can say, for example, look, Mr. Smith, if we don't tackle your diabetes now, we may well end up with problems with your eyes or your heart or kidneys. So you have to convince your patient in a polite and nice way, right? So moving to our next patient, this patient may be an angry, this may not be a patient, but might be an angry relative. And you have to deal sometimes with angry relatives in your practice. So you can say that Mrs. X, seeing your relative having a complication of an operation is a very big thing. And I can see that you are frustrated about this. You can say that if I were in your position, I would feel the same way. That would frustrate me too. And I would be asking the same questions as you are. So you are acknowledging the anger, right? And then you can say, would you mind if I look into the situation a little bit further? I think some of the details need to be clarified as I wasn't involved in that situation that you are talking me about. You can say, Mrs. X, it's actually very important to us that we minimize harm and suffering for our patients. And this is the last thing that we would want to happen to our patients. And I assure you that we will look into this fully. But if you wish to take this matter further, then of course I can explain the complaint procedure to you. That is your right, and I am happy to go through things in this regard with you. Then you can say that I will discuss this with my team member or with senior members of staff. I will also fill up the significant event report form. I will make sure to discuss this issue in our clinical event meeting so that it can be prevented and does not happen with anyone else. You can explain to the relative that you have every right to make a formal complaint if you think that your care or your patient's care has been compromised. And what I can do, I can get you in touch with Paul, which is Patient Advisory Liaison Service, and they will guide you about how you can submit your complaint. So this is how you can satisfy an angry relative. Next is that some patients are very demanding and they keep asking for something very specific which they bring in their mind when they come for consultation. For example, a patient might be asking for a scan. So how you can deal with this, that I know you really want the scan and I promise I will come on to that shortly. I appreciate that you want the scan. We advise a CT scan for certain types of problems. So let me once examine you and check what's exactly going on. Then we can decide if it is required for you or not. You shouldn't say straight away no or yes, because sometimes you might agree that patient should go for a scan. So you shouldn't say straight away no or yes. You can say that unfortunately for me to make any decision, I need to ask a few questions first. I hope that's okay with you. Could I ask why you would like a CT scan? Has anything in particular worrying you? Is there anything in particular that you hoped the scan would show? Sometimes patients say, doctor, I need antibiotics. Give me antibiotics. So you can say, Mr. John, we use antibiotics for certain types of infections. Giving antibiotics in conditions where actually they are not needed at all can cause many serious side effects, and also different bugs develop resistance against them. So let me once examine you and check what's exactly going on. Then we can decide if giving antibiotics is reasonable or not. Then there is a patient you may have to deal with who is refusing treatment. How to deal with this type of patient? You should remember that you should never try to force your decision on the patient. In this case, sometimes you also need to check competence of the patient. And most importantly, it's the patient's right to decide with medication or treatment they take or refuse. So you can address that you are absolutely right. You have every right to be involved in your own treatment, and no one can force you to take any type of medication or treatment. Our job as a doctor is to go through the pros and cons and make sure you understand that, and then allow you to decide for yourself. But would you please tell me why you are refusing treatment? Would you mind telling me why you don't want this treatment? Does the medication concern you in any way? It is a fear about side effects. Or do you have any concerns about addiction problem on the medication? Or is there anything else bothering you? Do you have a worry about your job being affected by the medication? Mr. X, I can see that your job is really important to you, and I can understand why you think this medicine may cause problem for you. For example, if a patient is a driver and he is concerned that he might not be able to drive after taking this medication. So you have to explore patients' concerns, and you have to address these issues. You can say, I can see how you may feel against these medications, given your relative had some nasty side effects. I can completely see where you are coming from. But then you can explain to the patient that the reason we usually give this medicine in this situation is that if we don't treat this condition with it, potentially you could have serious complications. It can even be life-threatening in some cases. Our next patient is who wants to leave hospital against medical advice, who doesn't want to stay in the hospital anymore. So how you would deal with this patient? Check competence of the patient. Try to find out the underlying reason why the patient wants to leave the hospital. Ask, is there any particular reason that's stopping you from staying in hospital today? Mr. X, I can help with certain things that can be causing you to need to go home. It is understandable how you may feel like this. No one wants to be in hospital. Let's see how we can make your recovery as quickly as possible. You can explain the reason why we want you to keep you in the hospital is that your condition needs to be monitored closely. Otherwise, things can go either way. You can say that I don't want to worry you too much, but your situation can be life-threatening if not treated now. It is really important that you understand that and stay with us until it's safe for you to go home. So you have to tell your patients the actual situation. You can further explain that your health is our priority. We need to make sure that everything is all right for you before you leave the hospital. You can ask, can anyone else look after your kids, or you look after your pets, or who can manage your issues at home rather than you leaving the hospital before time? It is for your own safety and for your own benefit, and we are stopping you because we are worried about you. You can ask, is it possible you can call the place of work and explain what's going on? Maybe they can relieve you unless you are completely fine to go back to your job. Mr. X, you are right. We can't stop you against your wish. But could we have an alternative plan in place? Because I am still worried about you. Is it possible for you to come back within the next few hours or next few days to see a specialist or to have the test you need? You can say this when your patient is not agreeing with you to stay in hospital. So you have to come to a middle ground. You want to agree on something which is in the best interest of your patient. If patient wants to leave the hospital, at least you should make your patient agree to come back within next few hours or few days for a follow-up and to have the remaining test done and to receive the treatment. And then while dealing with patient who refuses treatment or who wants to leave the hospital, you have to check the mental capacity of your patient. How you check mental capacity is very important to know, right? So you have to check whether patient is able to understand. So you should ask, can you tell me what you understand from what we have discussed? Next step is checking retention of the information. You can ask, I have mentioned a lot there. Could you repeat what I have talked about so I know I haven't confused things? Third thing is that you have to check, can they weigh up the information? They know the benefits and disadvantages of their decision and advantages of their decision. Can they weigh up pros and cons? So you can ask, are you able to tell me what is running through your mind? You can put this question. Then last thing is that you need to check, can they communicate the decision? So you should ask that, are you able to tell me what you have decided? And after asking this question, if your judgment is that your patient has mental capacity, and even then he is refusing treatment, or even then he is willing to leave the hospital, then you have to respect the wish of your patient. You cannot force your decision on your patient. Now coming to that, there is one patient who says to you that, doctor, it is very annoying. One person is giving one advice and the other is telling something else. Your nurse is telling me something else and the physiotherapist is telling me something else. I'm very confused, right? And I'm very annoyed. So how can you deal with this situation, right? You should say, I can see that this has upset you. I can see that you are frustrated and confused because of this. I sincerely apologize for this. I sincerely apologize for what has happened. I will investigate. I will look into the notes. I will look into the matter myself to see what the original plan was. And I will make sure that I can see the root of the problem. And if patient is still not satisfied, then you can say that I will ask one of my seniors to look into this matter and give their opinion. Or I am going to check with my consultant what is their opinion and look into this. So this is how you manage this situation. And this is the end of this part two. I just want to show this medical disclaimer that this information is not intended to be a substitute for professional medical advice, diagnosis, or treatment. My video is just for educational and learning purpose, and always consult your healthcare provider before making any decisions about your health. And coming to the end of part two, thank you for watching. And don't forget to watch part one and the remaining parts of my IPS video series. Please subscribe to my channel for new and interesting videos. And thank you very much for bearing with me. And see you next time with remaining parts of these videos. Thank you very much.